After a century of importing virtuosos from Europe, America suddenly produced its first generation of brilliant young pianists. They emerged in the late 1940s and early 50s, the protégés of illustrious émigrés who brought with them the culture of classical music. At home and abroad, these gifted young men thrilled audiences with their sensational talent and their promise for the future. But over the next two decades, almost all of them began to seem cursed, as one after another, their stories turned tragic. Byron Janis continued on the course of his career, although, as it turned out, he too met with enormous obstacles, fighting a valiant battle against pain and disability that went on for over 20 years in secret.
Frankly, I don't know how I did it.
I think that is somewhat of a miracle that Byron has played at such a high level for so many years.
How he played under those circumstances is really a mystery, I suppose, to all of us. Just a lot of grit and a lot of character and a very brave human indeed.
Somehow, it was meant to be for me. I was challenged all the time to keep going. I took the challenge. I knew I had to do it.
Byron Janis was born in 1928. His Russian mother, Hattie Horlick, and Polish father, Samuel Yanks, had met in America and soon settled in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. Byron attended kindergarten at the Colfax School.
Can't believe it. And I think this was 75 years ago, 76 years ago. And I tell you, this is a very important room in my life, a very important place in my life, the Colfax School. Because when I was four, we were asked to bring our favorite toys to school. I had a xylophone, which was given to me, and I said, I want to bring my xylophone. Now, this is yours truly, age four. And I stayed on the floor and played my xylophone. I played just what she was playing on the piano. And then she said, can you do that on the piano? I did exactly the same thing that she was doing. Well, that's how it started.
In New York, Byron was enrolled at the Columbia Grammar School on West 93rd Street.
One day, I stayed here to play softball. I was excited. I knew there was going to be a softball game. I was chosen last by a team that was forced to take me. And I hit a double, two bases. For me, that was a tremendous accomplishment. And I was in. I was one of them after that, and I liked that feeling so much that they realized that I wasn't only a pianist.
Like most boys his age, Janis was rambunctious and occasionally reckless. An injury that would have been traumatic for any child nearly put an end to his hopes as a pianist. In retrospect, it was the forerunner of the long litany of medical problems he would face later in his career, and the first of many occasions when he would find the will to overcome enormous adversity.
When I was 11, I was chasing my sister, and I guess what was a fight, and I ran ahead of her into a small dining room, which had a French glass door. So I put my hand through that door. And that would have been all right, but I removed it very quickly. And in that removing of it, I did a good job of cutting the tendon. This joint, as you can see, is this last joint. Does not bend at all. And until today, this finger is totally numb. It's the first American to go on a cultural exchange between the Soviet Union and the United States. It was 1960. Llewellyn Thompson was our ambassador, and he said to me, thank God you've come because the Russians are saying America can only produce cars. The total propaganda was that we were simply uncultured. And I played, and it was so beautiful to see how music overcame this hostility. By the end of the concert, it was extraordinary because these people were coming to the edge of the stage and really sobbing. And I said to myself that this is not just music. They know I'm not their enemy. I'm just a human being like them.
His success in Russia catapulted Janis into the spotlight. In America, he was hailed as a cultural hero.
We're here performing Prokofiev's Toccata from Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, American pianist sensation, Byron Janis.
At home and abroad, Janis's renown continued to grow as he pursued a full calendar of international engagements.
Then the arthritis came.
Inflammation and damage to the cartilage and bone in these joints, as well as some of the joints of the fingers themselves.
The arthritis was constant, but as long as he could maintain his high standards, Janis refused to give in to it or curtail his performing to accommodate it.
Remarkable and is remarkable about Byron is that he has pain every day. It's just a matter of whether the pain is a little better or worse that day. And pain like this from arthritis actually gets more intense when you put mechanical pressure. So, for example, playing the piano and using your hands will cause even more pain. And in his playing, one can imagine that each of these joints was a potential source of pain.
You can play through pain, as many athletes will tell you.
When a person has chronic pain, the medicines will reduce them to a point, but at some point one has to live with a certain amount of pain. And then the individual's willpower, his drive, his ability to overcome will have to take the place of medications. And what we saw in Byron is that the medicines didn't cure the disease. The pain was always there, but his will and his drive to be outstanding and creative led him to perform through the pain.
Janis would eventually undergo 5 operations on his hands, any one of which could have ended a pianist's career.
There was a time, even as recently as last year, where a pin had to be placed into his thumb in order to stabilize the joint and allow a tendon transfer to be made.
Arthritis dictated the rhythm of Janis's life, with his daily routine designed around managing the pain just enough for him to continue.
Most of that time I knew him was when he was, if you will, in the closet. Only a few people knew that he had arthritis. He had very high standards, and he couldn't let anybody know that whatever problems he was having was due not to just some loss of competence, but by a disability.
Keeping it a secret was to me as though I simply didn't have it. Nobody knew I had arthritis except my doctor, Maria, and a couple of friends.
He hid his problems very successfully and played spectacularly well. If a performing artist is known as having a physical problem or any other kind of problem, it of course makes it very difficult for him or her to follow a career. Word gets out that the artist in question is damaged and in some way, and folks, they want to be able to count on the artist. They want to feel that they're up to the challenge of performance, which is always a difficult one to meet.
What did you do about your fingering?
Change it all the time. I would change it depending upon which finger was inflamed of the day or of the night. It wasn't easy, but
Let me show you one little place that occurs in a Mozart concerto. It's written like this, look. And I have trouble reaching from there to there. Very hard for me. So what I did was... I used my right hand.
You used your right hand thumb.
Yeah, or second finger.
But this must be... I mean, this is so difficult when you have to take whole pieces and redo them.
You do it, and when you come into the difficult spot, you say, okay, how am I going to overcome that little spot? It was an adventure, but I did it, and that's how I kept playing, really.
In 1985, no longer able to tolerate the side effects of his medications, Janis decided to go public with the battle he'd been fighting.
The Arthritis Foundation approached me, and they are the ones who said, well, let's do this in a big way. Let's do it at the White House.
You all would be interested in knowing that that beautiful music came from a man who has suffered terribly from arthritis for 12 years. An awful experience for anybody, but for a pianist, it's particularly shattering.
The disease is still with me. The joints don't bend. A severe limitation of motion. I have it, but it does not have me. Actually, I'm grateful. I would not change places with anybody today. I would not ask for another pair of hands if I could have them at 20 or now.
Because whatever I have learned has made me what I am.